Hello and welcome to another episode of ArtBox. I'm your host, Jason. In this episode, I sit down with Phil Berneburg in the studio. And Phil is a studio art spotter with over 20 years of experience. He's a geologist and a ceramics engineer as well. As you'll hear in the interview, we go over to how Phil got his start in ceramics and in pottery. And we also go over his process. And we also go over some words of advice that he has for fellow artists and potters. And towards the end of the interview, we go over another project that he's involved with now, and it's called the Washington Street Art Gallery, and it's a gallery for potters and other artists, as you'll learn. And it's also a place for a community to come together, especially the potters community. And it's a place also for learning. They also have students there, as you also learn in the interview. So, as I say in the radio show, which, by the way, airs on Thursdays at 7:30 on WERA 96.7 FM, as I say, with that, let's go to the interview.
I guess, and actually, ceramics was sort of almost a second or a diversion. I went to school for geology. My undergraduate and graduate degrees are in geology. And when I got out of graduate school, nobody was hiring geologists. So I was looking, and I just finished 2 years of graduate school. And I actually got to the point where I had $14 left in the bank, and I was looking at next year's tuition bills. And I thought, this isn't going to work. I'm going to have to get a job. So I was living in Boston at the time. I got a copy of the Boston Globe and started looking in the health wanted sections just for some place to start. And the first ad I looked at happened to be for exactly the specialty I had been doing in graduate school, which was X-ray crystallography, which was the X-ray analysis of minerals, but it was in geology. And the job was with an aerospace company that wanted somebody to do X-ray analysis of ceramics and advanced materials, aerospace materials. So I ended up leaving geology, or at least the study of geology, to go into ceramics. And basically, ceramics are just man-made rocks. So it was a logical and a fortunate and just a logical transition. So then I ended up working for a succession of companies basically doing advanced ceramics research. And advanced ceramics, and so for 30 years I worked basically in what I call advanced ceramics, none of which has anything to do with clay. It's all, there are other kinds of ceramics, like for instance, most people don't realize, but glass is considered a ceramic. So the field of all glass study is part of ceramics. Concrete and cement is actually part of ceramics. And so if it's not a metal and it's not a plastic and it's not organic, it's basically considered a ceramic. So for 30 years, I worked for a variety of companies basically doing either corporate research for industrial products or aerospace type research for government contracts. But all basically these unique kind of specialized kind of ceramics. I worked, for instance, for one of the more recent ones, I worked on a small contract that was part of the development of the tiles for the space shuttle. And I worked on, remember the original Apollo vehicles with the heat shield, and I'd always show it re-entering with the heat shield. Yeah. I worked for the company that developed the heat shield. And I worked on development of ceramic armor tiles for the helicopters in Vietnam. I worked on development of the catalytic converter that's in your car. That's actually a chunk of ceramic, or ceramic pellets that's in your car. I worked on that when I worked for Ford for a while. And I worked on, like turbochargers. They're making ceramic turbochargers because you can operate the engine at higher temperatures. So I worked on the development of ceramic turbocharger rotors for automobiles. That was part of Ford and some of the other companies. And a lot of other sort of, none of these items were consumer products. These are basically all for industrial products or components of some kind of machine or some kind of device or government research. So I ended up doing that for about 30 years. I was doing ceramics research, and I'd always been interested in arts and crafts, but I never had a chance to study it very much in school. I'd done mostly on the side. And about 30 years ago now, I was living down in Potomac in Bethesda area, and I happened to go down to Glen Echo Park for the Folk Music Festival, and I'm wandering around, and there's this pottery studio, and it's called Glen Echo Pottery. Yeah. And so I sort of wandered in, because I'd been going to a lot of craft shows and things like that, but I wandered into the pottery, and one of the students there, a woman, kindly took about a half an hour to show me all around, because I was interested in it, because I'd been doing ceramics for my job. Although a different form. And so he was really, really kind. She took me around, showed me everything, and I was instantly hooked. I've been thinking about a place where maybe I could take lessons, but I'd never found one. Yeah. And this, the guy that operates, that operated then, and he still operates, is named Jeff Kirk. And he did a great job, because one of the things he did with this studio, this is like a lot of other studios where you can take classes, but one of the things that he did was he created an environment where, as a student, you got to feel like you owned part of the studio, and you got to feel like you really belonged there. And he also had, it was very unscheduled, so that basically once he got to know you, you could come in and work anytime you wanted to. So if you were taking classes there, you could literally, any other time that there wasn't something going on, you could go into the studio and work. So you really, he had a great sense of creating a community. And it was incredibly successful. So I was there. I took classes there, and then I ended up teaching classes there. I ended up teaching there over a period of like 25 years altogether. And I only recently, about 5-10 years ago, when I moved away, I basically pretty much stopped my affiliation with the place. But that's where I learned how to throw, or originally learned the pottery. But I think ultimately the thing I'm really in pursuit of beauty. Of one kind or another. It might be beautiful women, or a beautiful stream, or a beautiful tree, or a beautiful leaf. And I think really what I realized, what I think my work is about, or what I like to do, is create something that when I look at it, will try to recreate in me, and hopefully in maybe somebody else, the same feeling of sort of amazement and wonder that I get when I see something. And so I'm not a narrative person. You know, like some kinds of art basically tells a story, or some kinds of art is political. I have a lot of political views, but I'm not interested in expressing them in the art. To me, the art, my art, and a lot of art to me is reflecting and expressing and translating beauty of various kinds. So a lot of my inspiration comes from nature. I've been heavily influenced in studying in the past from especially Asian ceramics, Japanese, Thai, Korean, Chinese, so forth. So a lot of the stylistic things that I like to do are sort of based on some of the Asian and the styles. They're clean and they're simple. I mean, there's a great, I used to make, one of the things I used to do a number of years ago was I made a lot of pottery for Ikebana, which is Japanese flower arranging. And I didn't do the arranging myself, but I had to learn a lot about it in order to make the containers for it. And there was a saying that one of the women that I was working with who did Ikebana said that American flower arranging is you have a vase and you see how many flowers you can get in the vase. And when you can't get any more in, you're done. Japanese flower arranging is you put flowers in a vase, and when you can't take any more out, you're done. A lot of negative space and a lot of simplicity. And so, and I like a lot of clean lines and that sort of thing. So again, I like that. To me, that's very inspiring. And to me, that's also part of beauty. Is the simplicity and sort of the straightforwardness of not, it doesn't have to be very complex. And in some cases, the more simple and straightforward, the more beautiful it is, to me at least. You know, and that connects with the fact that because of my geology background, I'm also really interested in geology, and this is part of my love of nature. And in particular, this part of Maryland and West Virginia has some really interesting geology to it. And one of the things, in a house that I have, a studio that I have here in Harper, near Harper's Ferry, I have a large fern garden, basically. I didn't plant them, they were there. But one of the things that I love about ferns that again, attracts me to them, beside their own beauty, is the fact that it's an ancient plant. Yeah. It's a plant that's been around for millions of years. And so part of me is, again, is that reverence for this organism that has existed this long. So I made some work where basically I was using the fern as a resist, where I could put the fern down. A stencil is basically this, is where you have an opening, but this is a resist. So I'm putting this down as a resist, and I paint a contrasting color of clay over it with the clay that I've laid it on, and then I can peel off the fern. So I have the fern showing through from the clay below, and then a contrasting, usually a darker color around it. And so I can pick up the impression of the veins and the texture of the fern, but I can also get the color depending on how I color it later on. So I like to do that a lot, you know, is use textures and use some of the forms from nature. And I like actually, in some cases, to actually use them directly. Rather than try to sketch them or copy them, I want to actually incorporate the actual item in it. So I do that a lot. Yeah. And I'll make molds of things, that sort of thing. I peel off the fern and then go ahead and process the rest of the clay. And then I'll turn that slab of clay that has this fern pattern on it into something. I'll make a dish out of it or do something and manipulate it further to make something out of it. Yeah. So I'm using it just to sort of create part of the design. The steampunk was inspired by the fact that essentially steampunk is Victorian science, or it's basically you know, you think of it as like spaceships but put together with rivets. Yeah. And Jules Verne, for example, was one of the early practitioners, though at the time when he was writing and thing, that wasn't considered called steampunk. It's more of a modern subculture, but he was basically doing steampunk. Yeah. And so part of it, again, is the imagination involved, because to me, at least, one of the aspects of steampunk is that there's a story behind, if you create whether it's a drawing or a painting or something, there's a story that goes along with it behind it. So it's not just, the item is not just a freestanding item. There's a story or a background to it, which is part of the creation. You create this background to explain the piece. And so, yeah, so a lot of these, so some of these steampunk pieces that I made, I was combining sort of my love of some of these natural forms, and also, and sort of some of this sort of heavy industrial kind of science fiction, like boilerplate science fiction sort of thing, that I could combine all in one pieces. So it was actually, it was a great opportunity to sort of bring together a number of different sort of influences, a number of different ideas. Because of my my engineering background and so I've got a little different approach to making ceramic art, is that because of my engineering background, where I was doing a lot of tests and a lot of exploration, most of my work, I consider actually, I mean, I kid about it, but almost everything I make now is a test. Because in every single, and I'm not a production potter. If I make two things alike, that's a rarity. But so everything I make, I'm exploring something different. I'll make one of something and I'll decide I want to make some kind of a change to it, or I'm curious and say, well, I want what happened if I changed this. And so I'll make a change and I'll make another piece and explore that. So every single piece I make is in essence some kind of an exploration. And I think, and a lot of that, and I do a lot more testing of glazes and clay materials, and I think, than a lot of other potters do, only because that's something I love to do, and it's in my, it comes from the engineering background, the research background, where you're constantly doing a lot of tests. So, yeah, so I mean, and I keep rigorous notebooks of everything, just about everything I make, I have in a notebook written somewhere, so that I can recall it. So that, for instance, and I've seen good examples of this, where I might have done developed a glaze or something 20 years ago, and I just developed it and I looked at it and said, yeah, that's nice, but I'm not sure what I want to do with it right now. And 20 years later, I might say, you know, I remember I had a blue glaze that would be perfect for this piece I'm working on now. And because of the way I keep my records, I can go back and find it and I can recreate it. Yeah. And to me, that works really well. Yeah. The other thing I found also is I literally have some pieces that I've worked on for 20 years. And I've made some pieces where I get them up to a certain point, and I realize that I had intended to finish them a certain way with certain colors or certain glazes. And then when I got there, I thought, you know, that's not going to do it. It's not either my view of what the project had changed, or I was able to get a more graphic idea of what it was going to look like. And I thought, no, I don't want to do that. So I'd put them aside until then I'd go on with other work and other research until I could think back about them, say, now this would be suitable for this work. And I had a good example of that a while back. I had a platter that I made about 20 years ago, and I got it to the point where it was ready to be glazed and fired. And I really just couldn't decide what I wanted to do with it. And I didn't want to ruin it. And so I put it aside, and then I finally decided on wood firing. But that was 20 years. So 20 years after I made it, I wood fired it and finished the piece. And I've done that a number of times, putting things aside until I'm really decide what I want to do that's appropriate for the piece. And the other thing that I've been fortunate about to doing that is partially because of my industrial background, but also just because I'm curious, I've probably tried just about every ceramic process that there is at one point or another. And I don't necessarily pursue them all to great depth, but I try them to find out a little bit about it and to see whether, is that something I can add to my portfolio in a sense, or is that something that I can use in the future? So that I'm able to go back and say, yeah, okay, now I'm learning about wood firing, which I hadn't done for a long time. Now I'm learning about it, and then I can make the connection and say, ah, now this fits with my goals that I had for that piece 20 years ago. Only at the time I didn't know it because I hadn't even gotten into that field. So I do a lot of that also. there are a lot of different, this is one of the other great things that I love about ceramics and pottery. There are so many different directions you can go. Pottery is an incredibly process-heavy art. There are so many different steps to making pottery or ceramic art, and so many different processes involved. There's also a lot of science involved in it. And so there, at every stage in the process, you have almost an unlimited variety of choices that you can make in terms of moving forward. And one of those, the final ones, is the firing method. And so there are lots of different ways of firing the final ceramic, where basically you're either maturing the glazes and creating this glass coating, which is the glaze, and you're also helping the ceramic to get harder and denser and stronger. But the different firing methods create different color palettes and different surface textures and different looks to the ceramic. So you have a choice of how you want to fire it, depending on, again, this is another contribution you can make to the work in terms of the surface texture or the color. So you can have electric kilns. When you think about it also, if you go back, now a lot of people use electric kilns, but up until the early 1900s, everything was fired by burning something. Yeah. There were no electric kilns. So everything, it might have been burned at a low temperature, like in a campfire, or it might have been in a big industrial furnace with wood or coal or gas, but everything was fired by burning something. So we can still do that. So we have electric kilns, we have gas-fired kilns, I have a propane kiln in the backyard. You can fire kilns by burning wood. I have a small wood-burning kiln. The goal is still the same, to fire the ceramic and finish it and help the glazes mature and become that glassy coating and also add some color and texture to the work. But you have all these choices as to, again, how you want to add to the, that's part of the creation of the work. Typically, I mean, the basic process steps is you'd make something out of the clay, whether it's thrown on the wheel or whether there's another whole area called hand building, which is everything but the wheel, or even sculpture. So you make something out of the clay, you dry the clay out, and that can be a very involved process depending on what you're making, but you let it dry. Then typically, you fire it the first time in the kiln, and that hardens the clay and makes it handleable, but it's not its ultimate strength. Then you would put on a lot of the surface decoration, maybe the colors and stains or glazes, and then you'd fire it a second time to a lot higher temperature. And that does the final maturation of the clay, and it gets to its final hardness and strength. And then also whatever you put on the surface coating also matures and might become the glazes or the final stains. So, and each one of those steps, they're also sort of sub-steps. Well, the one thing that I found, it's very practical, but the one thing I found, and I mentioned it earlier, is keep a record of what you do. When I started out doing this, and it wasn't just because I was doing exploration and testing, but I'd make something and create something, and then later, and I think, well, I'll remember how I did it because I really liked the way it came out, and I'll remember it. Yeah. And then it wouldn't take very long before I realized that I don't have the slightest idea what I did. And that was, it was bad in two situations. If I really liked it, I couldn't reproduce it. And to me, this would even apply to painting. If you're mixing paint on a palette or something and you create a color that you like, I'd like to know at least, how did I do that? So that if I wanted to do that, what brand of paint did I use? What materials did I use to create it? And so it's the same thing. So one thing I would really recommend is keep records, even though it's kind of a pain, and a lot of people, I know potters that I know, that think it's taking them away from the creative process. And to me, it's amazing, because they're not actually sitting there working with the clay. You're sitting there doing book work, essentially. But to me, it's a huge contribution, actually, to your creativity, to be able to go back and look at what you did and see what went right, what went wrong, what did you do? If something really worked well, how did you do it? And I've been doing ceramics now for about over 30 years, and I still go back and I have a file cabinet full of notebooks, but I still go back and refer to them because I'll remember that, oh yeah, I got this great glaze or this great form that I made 20 years ago or something. What was it? I want to pick up on it again. Yeah. So I'm constantly revisiting also old ideas and saying, well, you know, how much further can I take it? Yeah. At the time, I took it as far as I could. I thought that I could take it, and something might happen. I might get an idea where I can say, you know, I can bring this further along, but I need to go back to find out what I did, and then how can I pick it up and continue it? And then analyzing them afterwards and saying, okay, what happened? And is there some good in the failure? A big part, one of the things that's really interesting about ceramics is, I think it's a little less controlled than some other art forms. There's still a lot of serendipity in ceramics, especially when it comes to the firing process. We have a fair amount of control, but not absolute total control, which is a good thing. And so happy accidents happen. And again, you want to know, you want to be able to look at it and say, well, okay, this is a complete failure, except for the fact that I got this certain color that developed on this side of this piece, and I don't know why, but I've never seen it before, and I'd like to use that. So to me, the failure and the exploration is also a really important part of it, is get out of the box. Don't just keep doing what you're comfortable with doing. Potters and other artists, where they get to a certain level in their development and their career, and they have problems or they have things they don't know, but they're afraid to admit that they don't know them because they think that other people think that they should know it by that point, and therefore they can't get help or they can't get the answers that they need. Yeah. And so I found there's a real reluctance, because I taught at Hood College for 13 years, and I've taught in a number of places. And I've seen a real reluctance from a lot of artists to ask help or ask questions. And there are people out there that know the answers, but they're afraid of what they're going to look like. And therefore, they're stuck. They can't get past that point. In some cases, it's a serious problem. Well, Dennis is my partner. Dennis Stark is my partner in developing the studio. And he and I were both members of the Potters Guild of Frederick. One of the things I realized that, and Dennis and I realized the same thing, there are a lot of artists around, well, all over the country, but even around here, a lot of artists, but most of them work in isolation. Most of them working in their own little studio in their garage or their basement, and they have very little contact with other artists. And there's no mechanism, other than a studio like this, where like Glen Echo or someplace we can take classes, there's no mechanism for people to get together. So one of Dennis's and my goals, we started off kind of independently thinking the same thing, was I'd love to recreate or create some kind of a community of artists where people could interact at a little different level, maybe than possibly at Glen Echo, where you're not all beginning artists, but where you can develop and grow and still and interact with other artists and get inspiration and so forth. And so and one of the things also that I realized, I've been affiliated with a number of other studios at different times, was that a lot of places, the format is fairly rigid, and so students get to a point where they've learned essentially everything they can at that location, and then it's like, well, how do I continue to grow? Yeah. You outgrow the facility, basically, or you outgrow the instruction or the equipment or whatever it is, and so people start getting restless, and unfortunately they leave, right, because they can't continue to grow and they can't continue to evolve. So one of the things we also had that in mind when we set up this place is we want to be able to have a place where we can continue to offer opportunities for people to explore and grow. And so there really isn't an upper limit. So that not just for the physical fact of losing people, but so for the fact for the artist's sake, so that they can continue to grow and expand and learn. Dennis and I kind of almost simultaneously were searching for something, and we had sort of the same idea. And we just started realizing that we were both also at a point in our lives and a career where we could do it, where we could afford to do it, and we wanted to do it. So we started looking around. I have my own little studio over here in Harpers Ferry. I've been here for a few years. And so I really loved it over here in Harpers Ferry. And so I started thinking that maybe this would be a good area for a studio. So we started looking around for properties just to see if there's something we could rent or buy. And I realized fairly early on that if possible, I didn't want to rent, because there's a big investment in setting up a studio in terms of equipment and space and arrangement. And that's all, the cost is all on you. And if you lose your lease or the rent goes up, you're out. So I wanted the stability of basically owning a building. So when I started out, I was looking around for sort of, I guess, the traditional pottery studio space, which would be like a big open barn. And I didn't find anything. But then we found this the present building that we're in, and it was the original medical center for the town of Bolivar. And it was an old house built in the 1830s, to which a number of additions had been made and had been expanded, and was broken up into a lot of relatively small rooms. So we were able to purchase that building, and it turns out it was perfect for our purposes, because we could separate the different parts of the studio. We could have the wheel work, for instance, which can be kind of messy throwing on the wheel. We could separate that and control the dust and everything else from, let's say, the front part, which we were able to set up as a gallery. So it turns out, contrary to what my original thought were, having it divided up like that worked great, because we could have a kitchen right there in the studio and not have to worry about too much dust coming from the working side of the studio. So yeah, so it was basically it really came about 2 years ago, just because Dennis and I sort of were at the same point in our thinking, and we both had this sort of longing again to sort of create some kind of a community of artists. Well, the ironic part is the I should mention that the way that the studio functions right now, we really have two components to it. The original idea for the studio was something like a gym for potters. And the idea is that we would set up the studio and then potters would become members of the studio and they'd have 24-hour day, 7-day access to the studio and they could come and work as much as they wanted to. So they were basically using our equipment like you do in a gym. That was the idea. But we still have that, but not recently, and where we're talking today, we added a new building for classes. So we have a classroom building and then we also have essentially the member building. The really kind of ironic part was when we first opened the members building, which was the original medical center, we were just kind of outfitting and putting equipment in, and we started inviting people, started in asking whether they'd come through and see it and talk to us about it. And our first two members were actually painters, because we didn't, I mean, that was another thing is I mean, it turns out the studio is primarily set up for ceramics, but it doesn't have to be. I'd love to get a glass artist in here or something else that fits with what we've got. Yeah. It doesn't have to be exclusively pottery if it's compatible. For example, we've started to do a number of workshops on jewelry making. Well, that's very compatible in terms of equipment and space and everything with what we're doing. Yeah. So, but anyway, it was just kind of funny that our first two members, actually, we were showing them around and we showed them a particular space and they said, well, this is kind of nice. Would I be able to work here? We said, yeah, sure. Yeah, so we still have a couple of people who are painters and 2D artists, but most everybody else, at least as a member, is a potter. A lot of them are people that did pottery a long time ago, so they had some experience with it, and they're living now in a situation, for instance, where they don't have room for a studio themselves, or they wanted to get back into it, and they didn't want to commit to a studio until they had gotten a chance to get back into it and say, well, do I really want to do this? So, and we have potters of all different ages. Right now we have about 14 members, but we have potters of all different ages. They come from all over. There was a woman we had a while back who was coming now from Baltimore, almost outskirts of Baltimore. We have another woman who comes from fairly far down in Virginia. So a lot of them, they're not, definitely not all just from the Harpers Ferry. We have a number of people that come over from Frederick, a couple of people from down toward Rockville. This is where also I think it works is because unlike a class, you might not want to travel an hour to take a 2-hour class, but here you can spend the day. Yeah. So if you come, and even if it's a 45-minute drive, like this woman that's coming from close to Baltimore, if she can come at 10 o'clock in the morning and stay till 6 at night, then it's not much different than going to work.
Right.
So then the drive doesn't become that significant a factor. Yeah. So that was another thing that what we wanted to have this basically unlimited setup for time in terms of time and days, so that it would be worthwhile to drive the distance. We have a monthly meeting, by the way, called the Potter's Roundtable. It's the second Saturday of every month from 10 o'clock till roughly 12. And it's basically another opportunity for people interested in clay to get together and talk. You don't have to be a member. You don't have to be taking classes. It's free. It's just a gathering of potters. It's just the pottering. And the idea, and so part of it is unstructured so that if people just want to swap recipes or talk about problems they have or bring in their work and show it off, that's fine. But we also, I usually make a presentation at each meeting on some topic related to pottery, whether it's a firing method or glazing, or forming of glazes or something like that. And again, that's been pretty successful. And that's part of what we want to do. We want to engage with the local community at large. I should say one of my other goals for this place, and I've been looking for something like this for a long time, is I want this studio to become sort of a resource for potters. Yeah. Maybe I can't say a resource for artists because we're kind of specialized, but I want it to be a resource for potters so that if potters, it's a place for people to get together, to exchange information, and also maybe to come for solutions and this sort of thing to if they have problems or issues or they need suggestions or whatever. Yeah. So a big part of that is reaching out to the community and inviting the community in.
I want to say thank you to Phil for taking his time for doing the interview. And if you want to learn more information about Phil, you can go to www.hfclay.com. And you can also go to ArtBox's website, which is www.artboxdnv.com. We are also on Instagram at ArtBoxDNV, and our Twitter handle is ArtDNV. So once again, thank you for tuning in, and until next time, I'm your host, Jason.